So how do you, the diagnosis, and for me, this is, as with eosinophilic esophagitis, this is pretty simple. My job is to grab a scope and start scoping. But unlike UE, there's no consensus guidelines of when this happens. An adolescent with difficulty swallowing, or an infant with feeding refusal who doesn't respond to acid reflux therapies, there's good guidelines suggesting that they should be evaluated for eosinophilic esophagitis, because the other eosinophilic gastrointestinal diseases are so much more rare and have such a varied presentation. It's a much more challenging diagnostic measure. So while there are no guidelines, one thing you do, this leads to, is that there are mostly diagnoses of exclusion. If everyone with nausea and vomiting, if you evaluated everyone with nausea and vomiting for eosinophilic gastrointestinal diseases, you'd have a hard time justifying that, because you'd be evaluating a lot of people without eosinophilic gastrointestinal diseases. But essentially, you need eosinophils somewhere to make the diagnosis at all. And so endoscopic evaluations are the norm. And so you need increased eosinophils in mucosal biopsies. So an eosinophilic infiltrate on the biopsy is a requirement. And then you really should see lack of involvement of other organs. Really, the eosinophilic gastrointestinal diseases should be the gastrointestinal location or layer involved. And beyond that, really shouldn't have any other organ involvement. And there should be an absence of other causes of tissue eosinophilia. If there's a hypereosinophilic syndrome or another cause of eosinophilia, that really should then focus on treatment of that condition rather than a more rare condition. And so the differential diagnosis is similar to what Dr. Atkins mentioned. Intestinal parasites, you can see the ascariasis worm in the colon on the right, which is always it's always fun, one of the bigger worms. Malignancy can also cause an increase in eosinophils, leukemias and lymphomas. Inflammatory bowel disease, which I've mentioned, is more common than eosinophilic gastroenteritis, so we think about it more when we see eosinophils in the mucosal biopsies. There are hypereosinophil syndromes, and then there are rheumatologic or other autoimmune conditions like vasculitides and polyarteritis nodosa and Sjögren-Strauss syndrome that we also think about when we see eosinophils on tissue biopsies.